beginning was the Word, and the Word was made. Sister Wendy.
Sister Wendy Beckett is a Catholic nun whose passion for art has made her a television celebrity.
What I want them to pay attention to is the art.
Born in South Africa,
studying at Oxford,
and educated at Oxford, Sister Wendy has, for almost 30 years, lived a life of solitude on the grounds of a monastery in England. The BBC discovered her talent for making art come alive on TV. Her latest series, The Story of Painting, airs on PBS. Sister Wendy was in America recently, and Bill Moyers interviewed her at the Morgan Library in New York City.
Have you been struck, as many of us have been, by the paradox of a nun who's lived a contemplative life becoming a television star?
Yes. It's bizarre. It's the kind of thing only God would do.
God? Or a good television director?
No, because if I say God set up the conditions under which I felt I ought to do it, I'm speaking obviously metaphorically. But when one has had this blissful privilege of living in solitude, to feel one ought to give it up, even temporarily, for short periods, it's a strange thing to have asked of one, and that's what I meant. I feel that it's right that I should do it, but it's not a thing that I would ever have wanted to do.
Had you ever watched television before you were on it?
No.
Not even a furtive glance at over your shoulder at someone else's set?
Well, where would I see their set?
There's none in the monastery?
Hmm.
So what did you think when the lights came on and the camera was there? Did anyone tell you what to do?
Well, no, it was perfectly simple because I was talking to the camera and the cameraman and explaining it to them. And I was often very encouraged by the reaction of the assistant cameraman, whose face would light up, and I knew I was getting my point across. I've never found any difficulty in talking to a camera.
You didn't have a script?
No. No, I don't feel it's right to have a script because the spoken word is different from the written word.
And you just stepped in front of the camera and talked?
Yes. When I started, they say, what are you going to say? And I said, wait and see. Well, can't you give us some hint of what you're going to say? And I said, oh no, that would spoil it. It would take all the edge off if I've done it once. And I didn't know that I was asking them to make a great act of faith.
How did the BBC discover you?
Well, I think it happened. I'm not sure about this, but I think it happened through my writing for magazines, which a very intelligent young researcher read and thought she writes simply. She can communicate her ideas clearly and with a bit of sparkle. Perhaps she'd be good on television. And he asked if he could come to the monastery and see me. And then he went back and told the producer, who was making the film on the National Gallery, Sister Wendy would be very good in that film. And the producer said he was having no nuns in his film. And the young man persisted until finally, just to kind of, I think, to keep him quiet, the producer agreed that I could be brought up to London and they'd go around the National Gallery with me. And I thought it would be quite good to explain to people the things I liked about the National Gallery. So I did go up, and I didn't know you were supposed to be rather in awe of television producers. So in my bossy way, I sort of took over and took them around and talked about various work to the National Gallery and said, no, that was no good, and, you know, trivial art over there, but this. And they thought this might work.
Many nuns in this country have abandoned the traditional habit. You see them in modern garb. Did that occur to you as you began this series?
Well, the reason why I wear a habit is simply for the practical convenience. I never have to think about what I'll put on. I shave my head so I don't have to worry about a hairstyle. And since I wanted to give all my time to prayer, the less time I needed to spend upon myself, the better. So that's why I wear a habit.
What persuaded you in the first place to take up a religious life?
Oh, I wasn't persuaded. I had known from babyhood that's what I wanted to do.
But how do you know that?
Well, I wanted to love God totally, which, of course, is what everybody's called to do. But for me, because I've got a very small human capacity and are, in some ways, an inadequate woman, the only way to do it was to be a nun. So I've known always that I was going to be a nun. I was never even tempted to do anything else.
But how could you be so certain of that at such a young age?
Well, I suppose it's like somebody always wanting to be a doctor or a painter. I felt this is what I was made for.
Were you encouraged by your parents? Were they a religious family?
Well, they were religious in that I was quite certain that God mattered to my parents. They would never have missed going to Mass on Sundays. And also, they were naturally good people. I never knew till I was grown up that adults fought or could be spiteful or say nasty things about other people, because I'd never heard it from my parents. Children did that. But adults always spoke nicely about other people. They were always gentle and compassionate. And if we criticized anybody, both my parents would say, you know, no. That's not how we talk about other people. We don't say anything unless it's kind, do we, dear? So I had an upbringing of the utmost freedom and sweetness. I was very, very lucky.
So there was never a moment when you doubted, never a moment when you didn't feel like you wanted to belong to God?
Well, I knew that I belonged to God. It was just a question of, I wanted totally to belong, and with all this, I had a very willful, says my mother. Wendy was a willful child. So all this had to be somehow changed into goodness. And I was confident that God would do it. I can remember as a quite young child, sort of sitting and thinking, I can't wait till I'm a nun. 16 seems such a long way off. Because then I thought, once I'm a nun, it will all come right. I'll be different. And I had to learn that that can indeed happen. You can enter upon a very unreal time of life in which you're sort of pretending in your habit to be somebody quite different. I wasn't Wendy anymore. I was Sister Michael. And Sister Michael was quite different from that silly schoolgirl.
I'm not sure I understand that. How was she different?
She was different that she was wearing a habit and she was removed from all the temptations of being nasty to her little sister. Her life was completely ordered for her by the rule. And it took me some time to realize that I had to integrate Wendy, the real Wendy, that silly creature, with my religious life, because what God wanted was me, not to pretend me.
Mm. When you took that step, when you said, I'm giving myself to God, what exactly did you think you were doing?
I thought I was setting myself into a context in which God could take possession of me in a way I had not been free to let him do before. If I had been different, he could have done it always. But I was so weak that I needed that orderly setup. You know, that's the sound of a vocation. You need it. Not that you want it, but this is a life that you actually need if you're to be fully human.
And when you look back, do you feel this life filled a need?
Oh, yes. My life has infinitely surpassed what I hoped when I started. It's got richer and deeper and wider and higher as I've aged.
What do you do every day?
Well, I pray a lot. I mean, basically, that's what I do. I pray. I live in the sunshine of God's presence. It's absolute bliss. And although you might think this is bliss, dear Bill, compared, I can assure you it is not.
But living in solitude, how did you study the art? Where did you get
books and cards.
Postcards. The kind of postcard you can buy at the Pierpont Morgan.
Ah, yes, those wonderful ones. Well, mostly, I was given art magazines by friends who said, what can we give you? And I said, well, I'd love a subscription to an art magazine.
But you had no money to buy them yourself, did you?
And anything I liked the look of, I'd write to the gallery and say, have you got a card of that artist? And they'd send it back. Or I'd say to somebody, I'd like some postcards from a museum if you're going there, and they'd send them. And then I began to amass quite a lot of books because there were people who really wanted to give me an expensive present. Because, you know, art books are very expensive. Yeah. I've now got nearly as many art books as there are in this room.
Really?
Books. Yes, I've got an enormous scholar's library.
Well, when you would receive these books or when you'd get these postcards from museums around the world, what would you do with them? Would you?
Well, books, of course, read and reread and prop them up to look at the pictures. Cards, put them on the little stand.
And just contemplate them?
Contemplate them. Look at them. And this was something Oxford helped want to do because, as you know, at Oxford, especially with English, you read the texts and then you had to reach right down into your psyche and pull out your own unmediated reaction to those texts and write it for your weekly essay. All the books about the text you'd read in the vacation, the actual term timers are reading the texts and the sort of naked exposure, which is very difficult to do. Because you have to force yourself to be utterly true. And this is what I'm doing in art.
True to?
True to how I have reacted to it. Never to fake it. One way or the other. So to know how I feel about this work. How I feel as opposed to how other people feel. And how I am perhaps entitled to feel because I know a lot about the artist and his style, so that it's not just off the cuff, it's something responded to in the context of an artist's work. That isn't easy.
But when you look at a piece of art, sister, what arouses your curiosity? What are you looking for? Is there some irresistible point of contact?
I think if you are looking for something, you're in advance circumscribing what you will see. You have decided at some level. You can't afford to do that. You must feel absolutely defenseless to the work. I think if you know something about the artist, you can go defenseless with more confidence. Mm. But you must not let any biographical details or others' opinions sway you. You must be prepared to spend time. And that's why I think two or three works is as much as one can take in. And spend time with them. Look, perhaps walk away, come back, look again, let your eye roam around until it begins to sort of flower within you, which it will do.
Well, take, for example, you have such an eye for detail. Degas's The Dance Class.
Yes.
There, as you call attention in the series, here's this young woman sitting on the piano scratching her back.
Yes.
And suddenly, for the first time after I heard you say that, I begin to get inside the mind of the artist. Why did he choose that moment and that gesture over all others that were possible in a classroom like that? And you call my attention to that. I had never noticed that before. That hand at her back.
That's right. He rarely saw them as articulate animals, all those women. And like animals, you see, it was their bodily gestures.
And what's interesting is one doesn't always think of a ballerina as an articulate person.
No, we don't, you see, but for Degas, women were really a lowly form of existence. I'm slightly flattering him by saying he thought of them as articulate animals. I didn't like to say just animals. But he had in the highest degree that opinion that some poor benighted men still have, that women are not fully human. That's why he often compared them to cats.
Do you think that most of us at birth are born with the potential to respond to art as you hope we will when we watch and contemplate it?
I'm sure everybody has this capacity, but it's not activated.
Why is that? Is it because we're afraid of being laughed at, I sometimes feel intimidated by art.
Yes, well, I think a lot of it is the fault of art critics who speak in a kind of highfalutin way.
The gatekeepers.
Yes, that unless you're highly educated and very bright and know the right language, you really haven't got any rights to be having an opinion. So people are frightened. They feel they don't know. And so they're going to make fools of themselves. Well, one of the things I wanted to do, you see, in the story of painting, was to give them the feeling they did know. This is where these artists come. This is a movement, and then there was that movement. So they could have an outline into which they can fit their own immediate response. And if they're deeply moved, they know where to go and get the books now.
You talk about surrendering to the wonder of the story. What do you mean by that, surrendering?
Well, to me, it's a crucial noun or verb, surrender, because it means that you're not going to have labels, you're not going to defend yourself by the ramparts of your own ego. You're going to open yourself to what this has to give you. And that's not easy to do.
It's not the same as submission, is it?
No. No, it isn't. You know, the Muslim religion, that's what the word means. And to me, it's extremely beautiful because that's what all religion means.
Submission.
Submission. Surrender.
Surrender.
Surrender, which is something that, for me, involves sort of loving trust, where submission can be a kind of superior and inferior business.
Right, exactly. So when you ask me to give myself, to surrender to a work of art, what are you asking me to do?
I'm asking you to let this work speak to you without you setting up preconditions, without you in any way defending the fragility of your ego. Because works of art can often teach us things about ourselves we would rather not know. Mm-hmm. They're going to take you into another's vision only to bring you back to your own truth. Art will increase your own integrity, which is something perhaps people only maybe paying lip service to desiring.
I'm not sure what you mean by that. It increases your own integrity.
Well, our desire should be that we are men and women of integrity, of truth, that we are what we were meant to be, with nothing fake about us. Now, art is a great tester of the fake. Because it must be the real you that responds. And the more the real you dares to respond, the more the real you is there. You're exercising the muscles of your own individuality as opposed to your ego.
So there is in this wonder a sense of innocence that you look at this painting without a previous fixation?
Yeah. It's very difficult to do because our eyes are not innocent, but we must hope to make them so. We must refuse labels and prejudices. Just try to see as a child sees.
And a child sees how?
A child sees innocently. A child sees what's there. It doesn't see with labels and prejudices because it doesn't know about them. It just knows there's a thing. But of course, the child hasn't got the capacity to respond at great depth to the thing, which we have. So we try to get the look of the child that sees what's really there, and the response of the adult that sees from a depth of experience and has, if they're fortunate, words in which to make that experience audible for other people.
I'm willing to surrender, but how do I train my eye to look?
You train it by doing it. I mean, it's like prayer. How do you learn to pray? By praying. How do you learn to look? By looking.
Well, and seeing what?
Looking and waiting and going away and coming back and looking and waiting. And if you've done that with sufficient earnestness and nothing happens, no flowering within you, no sudden understanding that this is something magical and mysterious that you are now in contact with, then that picture isn't meant for you. Try again in a few years' time. Go to another one.
Mm-hmm. What has art done for you, other than make you a international celebrity, which you didn't want to be? What has art done for
celebrity.
You? What has art done for you?
Well, I suppose it's given me enormous joy. It's also increased my capacity to accept darkness and pain and not be too bewildered by them. It's, I hope, made me a more sensitive and more alert person. The one fatal thing is to be a zombie. And I think we're all in danger of living part of our lives at zombie level. Well, I think art helps one to be perpetually there, as it were.
There is?
There, alert, constant,
in
somebody.
In that moment?
Yes, in the moment. Because God's coming every moment. But we're not receiving him every moment, because we're not even noticing that he's coming. We're drifting through. Well, you see, in art you can't just drift. Art is demanding of you attention. And I would hope that it helps me to be a more attentive person all the way.
You said it had helped you to see into darkness and sorrow. Does art sometimes tell us things we don't want to know?
Yes, I think that's very true. And that's why I don't like saying art gives one great pleasure. Because it does, but it gives one great pain too.
It sometimes seems to me that we owe to great sin much of our great art. So much of the art that you admire was commissioned by popes and cardinals and princes who led debauched, corrupt lives. So many of the great artists had patrons who were themselves depraved. And I wonder what you think about this coupling between immorality and inspiration.
Well, I don't know whether we can say they were sinful. They were just stupid. Uninstructed. The only person we can ever say has committed a sin is ourselves, and even there we may be wrong, because only God can judge. We can say they did dreadful things, but what the heart was, only God can tell. So I feel great compassion for these poor, muddled popes.
How do you feel when you discover a discrepancy between the character of the artist and the quality of the work? I mean, David, during the French Revolution, had no second thoughts about thousands of people going to the guillotine. Picasso, we were talking about women, Picasso cruelly mistreated women. I mean, what does it say that a dreadful, immoral person, if one wants to pass judgment, can produce great art?
I think one must make an absolute distinction between what the artist is like and what the work is like. All that concerns us, all that we can judge, is the work. And as for the artist, either an artist creates art of the good in them, or an artist creates out of a desire for a good that isn't in them. I'm quite interested in artists in a sort of vulgar, gossipy way, but I'm not in the least interested in them as far as the quality of the work goes, which is why I particularly love medieval art, where we don't know anything about who painted it. And I think we can see more clearly, because it's very hard to look at David and not remember him voting for the execution of the king.
You've said that all art that really draws us to look deeply at it is spiritual.
Yes.
In what sense?
Because it's going to deepen our awareness of the things that matter. It's going to make us, to refer to what we said earlier, more a person of integrity, more true to my own essence than I would have been without this encounter. It's like meeting a great genius, just talking, even being in the presence of such a person. You feel enriched, enlightened. You're more than you were before you had that encounter. Well, that's what painting is perpetually offering us. Encounters, encounters of greatness.
Is religious art synonymous with spiritual
power? Not at all.
Not at all?
Religious art can be spiritual, but it can be very dull. Religious art works on an iconography, and it works to the extent that you believe in it. If you believe in this image, then the image will remind you of your faith and will have a religious effect.
It's a vehicle to God for the devout.
Yes, yes. A spiritual art will take you further than you knew you believed. It'll take you into uncharted realms.
And that spiritual power is what?
The spiritual power is this ability to lift us out of the confines of our ego, out of the traps that many people are in. Their relationships, their jobs, their worries, mortgages, health. And there they go round in the cage. And art opens a door and takes you into something bigger than yourself, something immensely exhilarating and refreshing. So when you come back into your cage, you know that's not all there is to life. You know, Kenneth Clark used to say, whenever he got deeply depressed, he'd go and look at something, some great work of art. And there it was, sailing through the centuries. He didn't use these words, these are my words. Untouched by all our littleness and our anxieties. And we're taken into that, not as an escape, but as a way of coming back into our anxieties, more able to put them into perspective. Art is a great means of getting perspective on all that's worrying, depressing, constricting in your life.
What did you mean when you wrote, all great art is spiritual? And I think you've made that clear, but not all great art is sacred. There's a distinction between the spiritual and the sacred?
Yes. Sacred, I think, goes deeper. Sacred is spiritual at its most profound and emphatic. Sacred, I think, is spiritual art where you know it's spiritual, whereas a lot of spiritual art you don't know. Your spirit knows, but you don't know. You're just delighting in it.
Well, what did you mean when you said that sacred art is the most intense communication of personal truth?
Because it's the artist's personal truth confronting your personal truth. If it's great art, if it's sacred art, the artist has managed to put their entire truth there in those images. And your truth encounters them to the extent in which you allow it to. And so you return to yourself enriched by encounter with the master's vision.
And what do you mean by truth here in this personal sense?
Truth is what you're meant to be, but haven't yet perhaps become. Truth is what God made you to be. All your qualities fulfilled. No dead sections that you were afraid to work with within you. No areas of negligence that you just didn't bother to take seriously. I suppose the only person who was wholly true was Christ, who said, I am the truth. But that's what we aspire to become utterly what we were meant to be.
What is your favorite sacred art that does this for you?
Well, I'm torn between saying Poussin and Cézanne. I think those are two profoundly sacred artists. It's more perhaps materially obvious in Poussin, who paints pictures of the seven sacraments, for example, but it's just as true in Cézanne, painting card players or the mountain or apples. A man whose vision was so almost painfully seeking to be utterly receptive to what was there, not to cheat in any way, that we become more uncheating when we encounter it. Because we all cheat, unconsciously, if no other way. But Cézanne helps us to be true.
Here's another paradox. In the ninth episode is the great sense of freedom. And wouldn't you agree, you say, that this great gift of the 20th century to artists was this growing sense that they weren't bound by the rules, they were free. But isn't that what has gone wrong with the 20th century? That the loss of boundaries, the loss of principles of life, the loss of tradition, the loss of convention and order?
I think one could say that's what's gone wrong. But as you know, it's a principle of theology that an abuse should not take away a use. The fact that one abuses something doesn't mean that something wasn't a good thing to start with. I personally like rules, well, I feel much freer within them.
Right.
But one should never be constricted by the rules. And I think this freedom is in itself a good thing. The fact that it's gone to people's heads and they've become very silly is very sad. But we hope it will pass.
Were you not offended when you looked at Andre Serrano's Piss Christ? Did you find that denigrating of the simple figure of your faith?
Well, actually, no, because I thought he was saying, in a rather simplistic, magazine-y type of way, that this is what we are doing to Christ. We're not treating him with reverence. His great sacrifice is not used. We live very vulgar lives. We put Christ in a bottle of urine, in practice. It was a very admonitory work. Not a great work, because one wouldn't want to go on looking at it once one had, to one's distress, seen it once. But I think to call it blasphemous is really rather begging the question. It could be, it could not be. It's what you make of it. And I could make something that made me feel a deep desire to reverence the death of Christ more by this suggestion. This is what in practice the world is doing.
So are there objective standards or criteria for great art? What makes a great painting?
Again, it's a kind of suck it and see reaction. If continually people look and look and always come away enriched, then it's a great work. But it takes time, you see, to discover this, that it's not just flavor of the month or flavor of the year. That's why it's very hard to make judgments on the works of our own time. We have to wait.
Mm-hmm. You say somewhere, I forget exactly where, that we moderns are called upon to make a practical and informed choice of the pure as opposed to the comforting. Can you give me an example of that?
I think comforting art is art that is very easy to react to. I might be tempted to say that the Serrano's Piss Christ is comforting art, in that everybody knows exactly what they think about it. They're not challenged in the slightest. 90% of them think it's blasphemous, and a few like me think, well, it might not be. It might be a rather ham-fisted attempt to preach about the need to reverence the crucifix. Not a very gifted young man, but he's trying his best. But that's comforting art, you see, because it's so easy to have an opinion and a reaction. Everyone thinks they can do it.
Jesse Helms would not find it comforting. Yes, I guess in
your
definition, he would find it.
He thinks he's right. and he hasn't had to think about it. It's obvious to him, and that's comforting. So nice to know I'm right. And there's quite a lot of art, you see, that gives that instant satisfaction of feeling that I know I can judge this without having to look, without having to take trouble. I just know because it's so obvious. That's comforting. Whereas, you see, the real art makes demands.
When you began your study of art, were you shocked by the number of paintings that dealt with the naked human body, with sex, passion, the carnal side of human nature?
It would never have entered my mind to be shocked. I can't think why one should be. Yes, but Catholics believe in God, you know.
Well, I know that, but American Catholics have also, for a long time, been very, shall I say, wary of public displays of.
Well, obviously, there must be something appropriate. I mean, I would be distressed if I was to see somebody as a naked walking down the street. I would think it was inappropriate behavior. I wouldn't be shocked. I would feel compassionate towards the poor person. But when you're telling a story in which often the point depends upon nakedness, or one of the great myths, where part of being a god is you can afford to be naked and unashamed, this is very appropriate. And the artists do this with great reverence and delight.
Well, there is a serious point here in the sense that you talk on camera before millions of people so unself-consciously of nudity and carnality and passion, all in the art that you observe, that one of your critics, Germaine Greer again, scoffs at the notion that a consecrated virgin can talk to us about these things.
Well, see, why does she think that anybody should not delight in the creative work of God? I mean, it's very illogical. God made the body. And this suggests that sort of God made mistakes about certain parts of the body. You know, that unfortunately, he's done these shameful things. We must do our best to cover them up. This is not the faith. The faith is that God looked at his creation and thought it was good, thought it was beautiful. We're made in the image of God. And there's nothing amiss in any part of the human body. But again, it should be appropriate. There's, to me, something far more salacious about these sort of sniggers and criticisms than in just a Christian delight in God's skill.
But you have to, surely you understand. I mean, you are a very sophisticated woman. For example, what would the nuns in your convent think if they heard you discussing the naked little slave girl in the tomb of Ramesses in one of the series, or where you compare the breast of the matron to the firm little apples of everybody else?
Well, they will see it, because the BBC will bring down a television screen and show it to them.
Well, what will they think?
They'll think, as I think, that this is quite a good description of the bodies we're looking at. None of the sisters has ever raised an eyebrow at anything I've said or written, because they're not cramped by this false idea that sexuality is something wrong. It's something we have sacrificed. The vow of chastity doesn't mean you just don't get married. It means that sexuality is something you give to God because you want to be free for something else. It's a wonderful gift. And I delight that people have it, though it's not a gift for me.
There's a moment you're talking about on
Grace.
Oh,
the anger, yes.
The bather of Valpincon. Ah, the back and light plays upon this whole beautiful body from the long neck right down to the cleave of the buttocks as though he sort of licked his paint.
Yes.
Adoringly over every part of her. And to me, it's a wonderful paradox that this great classic painter, the virtuous Ingres, should be one painter who so celebrates the beauty of the human body. I mean, that's a very sensuous, almost erotic moment.
Yes, but you see, he was the great classicist, and yet He's the most sensual of painters. Wonderful. And so I didn't want to do that painting. I wanted to do one of his great portraits, Madame, is it Le Mortissier? One of those great icons of a female. And the director was very keen that I should do this one. And I can remember in the Louvre looking at it, and suddenly I realized what made it so great. You know, he loved the back always on. It was his big thing. That isn't the only back that he savors. Often he makes them much longer than they are because he can't have enough of the back, so he added on more vertebrae. So they're wrong physically, but they're wonderful visually. And that's marvelous. It's a highly charged painting. It's vibrant with the sense of what it means to have a body.
And it's a spiritual painting.
Yes, because God gave the body, didn't he? God made the back. Ang was just improved on it by giving it a few more vertebrae.